Well, it's nice to be back in Zendo after a short vacation. Unfortunately, caught a little cold on the vacation and still a little bit left, so my voice is still a little bit funny. You know, life is important. And because life is important, your own life is important. And because life is important, your own life is not important. This is a paradox. When you think that your own life is important, you feel like you are the center, or you should be the center of the universe. You have some kind of idea that you're like the sun and everything else is going to revolve around you, so that you're like alone on the mountaintop, the highest and most important. And when we feel that our life is important, and we have this kind of feeling, we may feel kind of high. But actually, when we are high for that kind of reason, it means we cannot come down to the real world. And then things and the people will always seem at a distance and separate, because we feel our life is important. It's because the mind is standing in a very remote place and is limited by small space. This is the problem when we are trapped by the idea that our life, our personal life, is important. We separate ourselves. But when we know that our own personal life is not special, then we understand about the importance, the true importance of life. And it's very much like Dogen said, Dogen told us hundreds of years ago when he said, to advance oneself is delusion. To let things advance themselves is enlightenment. When that happens, we then know that it is necessary to let go of our self-centeredness and instead practice selflessness. And that's how we become awake, and how we help ourselves and help others. So if and when we come down from the mountain of self-importance, when we come down to the reality of life's true importance, then we can go anywhere. We are not stuck up on the mountain. We can go anywhere, and life has no limitation, and the mind has no limits. And when we know the way that which all life is important, then we know how to take our practice into our ordinary and daily life. We know what to do, and we know how to do it. And we will not forget what it is that we have to do. And we won't wait for somebody else to do it for us. The mistaken idea that somebody else will do it for us. and we won't avoid it, and we won't delude ourselves that there is no need to do it. So when we, by knowing the importance of life itself, we won't waste time. We simply won't waste time. And we will find all the good qualities, all the finest qualities that we admire. Humility and patience and courtesy and energy and clarity. But when we feel that it is my life that is important, we become careless. And instead of the most admirable qualities, we start to take on the least admirable. We become arrogant and foolish, lazy, and we speak without reflection. And we separate ourselves from people and from life itself. Our practice is about understanding the importance of life. And that our own life is important, but not in the way that we originally thought. We are all very old. We're very old. We are older than can be imagined. We can't count the years. Our age cannot be imagined. It cannot be fathomed. It's not like a tree, the age of a tree, where you can cut it down and count the rings to determine its age. That's relative. That's a relative age. Our true age cannot be measured in such a way, because our true age is beyond time and beyond the limits of our mind. And at the same time, we are young. We are very young. We are born fresh each moment. And the ageless world is also born at that same moment. So what is ageless and timeless shows its other side in each moment. Its active and creative and transient side. As Dogen said, it's like lightning flashing in the big sky. And lightning and the unchanging vast sky exist simultaneously. That's what our life is. So we are both ancient and new. We are both immovable and exciting. And usually we fall in love with the exciting part, but we forget the ancient part. Because we start to remember the ancient part is why we come to practice. There is a poem by the American poet Mary Oliver that I found many years ago that touched me very much, that speaks to this point. I would like to read it to you all the way through. Something just now moved through my heart like the thinnest of blades, as that red tail pumped once with its great wings and flew above the gray, cracked rock wall. It wasn't about the bird. It was something about the way stone stays mute and put, whatever goes flashing by. Sometimes when I sit like this, quiet, all the dreams of my blood and all outrageous divisions of time seem ready to leave, to slide out of me. Then I imagine I would never move. By now, the hawk has flown 5 miles, dazzling whoever else has happened to look up. I was dazzled. But that wasn't the knife. It was the sheer, dense wall of blind stone, without a pinch of hope or a single unfulfilled desire, sponging up and reflecting so brilliantly, as it has for centuries, the sun's fire. This poem speaks to the understanding of what life is. Its title is Knife. So, we are dazzled and excited and carried away by the beauty of this world. But when we settle our mind on the stone wall, staying still, quiet, reflective, ageless, then we know about agelessness and the importance of life. And then we are ready to know our life's intention. And this intention is not about achieving a particular goal in some future. Our life's intent is about how we show our other side, how we leap up and spread our wings, and also about how we express our agelessness, how we express our quiet and still and infinite wisdom. When we have no intention, we lose our life. But when our intention is known, we have true life. We have true life with joy. And then whatever we do, and wherever we are, and no matter what our circumstances are, and even if we have to carry something heavy in our life, we have true life. So, our practice is about bringing together agelessness and our continuous youth. This is our practice. It's like bringing together both sides of a sharp knife. A knife is a knife only when it is sharp. When both sides come together and disappear, then the knife can fulfill its true function. So the two sides of our knife have to meet each other. Imagine if two sides of a knife were parallel. They could never meet. And we couldn't say, this is a knife. Or if the two sides of a knife approached each other but never met, there would be a dull area separating them. To have both sides of the knife meet, without dullness, we have to sharpen them so that we can remove the separation. When the sides disappear, there is no more separation. And we cannot see the point where they meet. So our practice, Zazen practice, is how we sharpen ourselves. How we sharpen ourselves. We bring both sides together. We sit quietly and still like a rock wall, expressing agelessness, which is the taking off point for the coming into life of everyday being. Sitting quietly, we are readying our mind to take action, to fly away in all of our beauty, and to let our imagination go anywhere. This is the spirit of our practice.